morning, everybody, and welcome to our thought for the day for today. Again, looking at the life of Nehemiah, his book in the Old Testament. We've seen already how God has begun to work in him. We saw his principles of a great big God. We've seen that he believes in the power of Scripture in his life, and so bases his life completely upon it, the Word of God, and his commitment to prayer. And as a result of that, God starts to move in him as he hears the news about the situation back in Jerusalem. And God is going to use him, but I don't think Nehemiah has got any idea of really how that's going to be yet. All he does is God begins to work in him. And before God uses us, before God perhaps uses us to do his work, he's got to work in us sometimes to clear out the things that are in the way. And so this is a time where Nehemiah does that. He gets before the Lord, he prays, he seeks God's face, probably praying for the situation in Jerusalem, being very passionate about that. And as he does that, God convinces him that he's part of the answer to the issue, and God is going to use him in that. And so we've got things to learn from that, haven't we? For ourselves, as a church, as individuals as well. If God's going to use us, then we're going to have to be touched by the heart of God. And the way to do that is through patient, passionate prayer. And that's what we're going to look at this morning. But before we do that, well, let's pray together, shall we? Heavenly Father, we thank you for this great story we have, this great account that Nehemiah has written for us about how you used him all those years ago. And Lord, we pray that we can learn something from that again this morning, we pray. Not just learn it, but apply it to our hearts so that we become people of, like Nehemiah, who are used by you in whatever way you choose to use us. And we ask this in Jesus' name. Amen. So let's read this prayer that Nehemiah prayed, shall we, from verse 4 downwards, or verse 5 rather, downwards in chapter 1 of Nehemiah's account. This is what he says. Then I said, Lord, God of heaven, the great and awesome God who keeps his covenant of love with those who love him and keep his commandments, let your ear be attentive to you and your eyes open to hear the prayer your servant is praying before you day and night for your servants, the people of Israel. I confess the sins of we Israelites, including myself and my father's family, have committed against you. We have acted very wickedly towards you. We have not obeyed your commands, decrees and laws you gave your servant Moses. Remember the instruction you gave your servant Moses, saying, if you are unfaithful, I will scatter you among the nations. Well, but if you return to me and obey my commands, then even if you are exiled people, are on the furthest horizon, I will gather them from there and bring them to the place I have chosen as a dwelling for my name. They are your servants and your people, who you redeemed by your great strength and your mighty hand. Lord, let your ear be attentive to the prayer of your servant and to the prayer of your servants who delight in serving your in revering your name. Give your servant success today in granting him favour in the presence of this man, for I was cupbearer to the king. Now, Nehemiah had been praying for some days. Some people think it was around 4 months, 100 days, praying and fasting and seeking God's face about this situation. What's going to happen? The people are struggling. It's not about the walls. They're an issue, and we don't like to see the walls down, and it's bringing disgrace on your people. But it's the people that God actually put into Nehemiah's heart and made him, give him compassion for them. So how is this all going to change? What are you going to do, God? And he spent 100 days praying about this before he gets to this final prayer that we will look at more detail tomorrow. So there's some principles for prayer here. Nothing particularly new, but something we need to remember ourselves at the beginning of a new year as we're seeking God for his church here at Trinity and wherever you may be this morning. How did Nehemiah pray? He was genuine in his prayer, wasn't he, first of all? He sat down and wept, meant he was genuine. He was sacrificial in his prayer. He prayed and he fasted. Fasting is a good thing sometimes. It's not good if it's just a ritual where it's just done for, you know, no apparent reason. It's just part of the calendar, we do that. But when we choose to miss a meal or we choose to miss something else, so that we make time and buy some time back so that we can, and then we spend that time with God, that's sacrificial praying. And it doesn't twist God's arm. God doesn't listen to us anymore because we do that, but it just gives us, it shows in a sense to ourselves more than to God that we mean business and we are willing to give things up because God is doing something in our lives. And I don't know if you've ever tried fasting, whether you've ever done that, But it's not a bad thing to do. In some ways, it can be a discipline to get into, provided we do it for the right reasons. So that maybe some people I know who are good Christian men and women who give up maybe a meal once a week and would spend that time together praying, or would do it on their own and just spend some time on their own praying, because it's buying some time back and it's time invested in the presence of God, and that's never wasted, of course, is it? And so Nehemiah's done this daily. He's sacrificed his food and whatever, not because he's got to, but because he wants to. Because he wants to pray and seek God's face for these people. So he sacrificial prayer. It's not that it twists God's arms, but it really does help us to get to know God and his heart more. His heart and my heart begin to align together. He was persistent for some days, kept knocking at the door. He was encouraged in his praying. He encouraged himself by going back to the word of God that he trusted in completely and reading how God had worked in the past. And that encouraged him as he prayed. He looked at how God had dealt with his people in the past and said, "That's how you've done it. Lord, we want you to do that again. We want you to work in us. You're a God who does these things." So he kept reminding himself of how great God is. And one of the principles of praying, whether it's corporately or on our own, is to make sure we pray with our Bible in our hand, to open it up and to be reminded of us, remind ourselves of how good God is, how great he is. Perhaps it's good to start with a prayer time like that. The Psalms are in the Bible, I believe, for partly for that reason, just to lift our heads so that we can see how great our God is in this way. And so he's encouraged in his praying through God's word, and he was confident his prayers were going to the heart of God because he knew the heart of God, this great big God. There was nowhere else. Where else would he go? He had nowhere else to turn. He wasn't going to turn anywhere else because God was the answer. He knew that this situation was the way it was and God was the answer. How we need to capture that, whatever the situation, but particularly for these days, that whatever our situation, God is the answer. Because his view of God was, we've already touched on this, hasn't he? God is a sovereign God. He's the God of heaven, he refers him to. He's a mighty God. He's the great God of heaven. He's a holy God who we sometimes have to come and confess our sin to. We'll talk about that more tomorrow. And he's a compassionate God, a God who will act. He's not far off and aloof, but he wants to get involved. And so Nehemiah really does believe that this is God who's moving his heart. He's a faithful God. He keeps his promise. And he's a speaking God. He will want to speak to us, and he wants to lead us, and he wants to give us his word, and he does hear our prayers. So these are principles, really, that we learn here from Nehemiah as he gets before the Lord, as he prays. And God's, in a sense, sorting him out before he goes and gets Nehemiah to be the instrument of being able to sort some problems out in his church that he wants to fix in his people. And maybe that's what God wants to do with us. Maybe that's what God wants to do with you, that you need to spend time in prayer. You'll be praying for other people and other things, but actually what God wants to do more than anything else is to get close to you and to sort you out and to bring you closer to him. And the more we pray, the more we spend time with him, the more he will do that. So I encourage you, read this passage, read this prayer again. See what we can learn from that. We'll look at it again in more detail tomorrow. Nehemiah. This ordinary guy who God has touched and transformed mainly through prayer and fasting and just getting alone with God, and this man's conviction that God was with him. And we'll see how that works out in the days to come. But let's pray together now, shall we, as we finish this morning. Heavenly Father, again, we pray that you would bless our time this morning, bless your word to our hearts. Help us, Lord, as we come to you, and help us to seek your face in prayer. And to take some of these principles and apply them to our hearts. We ask this in Jesus' name. Amen. Thank you for joining us. Hopefully see you again tomorrow. God bless. Bye-bye.